Groans, grown folks nation, it's your love man here, and it's time once again for the Inside the Album podcast.
GrownFolksMusic.com.
Well, good, let's see, I'm trying to think. It could be good afternoon, it could be good morning, it could be good evening, it could be good anything. But what we really want to say is to welcome everyone, all the groans out there, tuning in to another podcast from the GFM Podcast Network, and really excited about what we're talking about and the artists we're talking about today. And we have some very, very special guests, and I guess this might be a record in the GFM books. Sometimes we go coast to coast, but today we are definitely international and really excited about that. So we'd like to introduce folks that we're going to be talking with today. We have DJ Polish Solid, who is a frequent contributor to the GFM, and always love her great mixes and the great work she does with these podcasts where we've been talking about Prince and some other artists, and we're talking about a different artists today. And we'd also like to welcome from the Music Snobs, esteemed podcaster and guest with us today, Jehan. So all the way from across the pond, as it were.
So thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So Polish Solid, you want to get us going here? Yes. A little context? Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm so excited about doing this podcast because Lewis Taylor is one of the best albums of all time. And yes, I'm going to say that. And I'm not lying.
No, you're not.
It's really spectacular. It came out in August of 1996. And to give you a little bit of context, D'Angelo's
Brown Sugar Babe
came out the year prior in 1995. Also in 1996, on the last podcast, we talked about Prince's that came out that year. But another really stellar release was Jamiroquai's
Traveling Without Moving.
One thing I think we'll probably talk about during this podcast, at least I'm going to talk about it because I sort of love British music, starting with my main man, Omar.
Okay.
There's something like this.
That's kind of how I started listening to all the UK artists that I actually listened to. It all started with Omar, but Lewis Taylor is very, very special. He has gone into musical retirement, and for a very long time, I was like shouting out in the world, "Wherefore art thou, Lewis? Why won't you come back to us, Lewis? You know, please give us more music." And then this year, actually, in 2016, Soul Jones, the Soul Jones blog, did an interview with none other than Mr. Andrew Taylor, because that's his first name, Andrew, middle name Lewis, and he sort of broke his silence, but if you actually read the interview, he really doesn't tell you anything. It's a very long interview, but the one thing that you kind of get is that he doesn't want to record music anymore, and it's sad, but I started to accept it now after that interview because, I mean, if you think about it, he's actually given us more music than D'Angelo has.
Wow. Like, right.
Yeah, if you put
Isn't that crazy?
Isn't that crazy? And so I can't hate him because, like, he has given us a lot of awesome music to listen to. When I was in high school, I had this guy tell me, you know, it's better to love than to not at all. And when I was a teenager, I was like, that is so stupid. Like, but now I understand, guy from high school. So I'm so happy that Lewis Taylor graced us with these amazing songs and albums. And if he chooses not to record anymore, I am going to be sad, but I get it. Sort of, kind of. So what's really great about Lewis Taylor, well, a lot of people might not know, is that he's like Prince in that he does it all. He is an amazing vocalist. He is an amazing guitarist, an amazing bass player.
Bring it down.
Singer, songwriter, producer, musician, really, really fantastic. One thing about his debut album that I sort of like, I don't know, is similar to me to the Madhouse project, is that conceptually all the songs are just one word, which I thought was really awesome. From the beginning to the end, there's not one bad song on the album. And the sequence of the album is truly extraordinary.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's one of the best sequenced albums ever. And it starts off with a really awesome introduction to Lewis Lucky. Like, so if you've never heard of Lewis Taylor and you kind of want to get a feel for him in one song, I think Lucky does that.
I get tired of this madness. I want what you got.
Personal favorite song, Spirit, which is an a cappella. Just the layering of his vocals is truly, truly amazing.
Hello, spirit of soul. I don't know where you've been. Yeah. Sometimes I get to feeling like I'm never gonna win. Oh, no.
Words, which are so simple.
Please help me.
The way he sings that, I so related to that. And whenever I'm in a depressed mode of being, and I listen to that song, even though the song can sometimes be depressing if you are depressed, it's also uplifting at the same time because you kind of understand that someone else has hurt and like they're asking for help. So I sometimes use that song when I need help, but I don't want to reach out to someone. So it's been a staple of my life to sort of listen to that song if I'm in despair. And I actually never really felt that with Prince until the Sign of the Times, the movie, when they come all, you know, to the stage and they're singing that All Right over and over again. Mm. And when Prince starts singing, you gotta tell you what you mean to me, and he starts screaming. And then the microphone drops. I don't know if he's crying or he's pretending to cry, but I feel that. So whenever I need to be spiritually uplifted through Prince, I actually watch that part of Sign of the Times because that's as close. But I can probably listen to any Lewis Taylor song and sort of get that upliftness only because, again, I feel that Lewis Taylor is actually the true definition of a soul singer because he touches my soul. Like every single time, as cheesy as that sounds, but really, truly, that touches my soul whenever I listen to his music. And if you read that Soul Jones article, he talks about how he is so musically inclined that he can mimic anyone vocally and also musically. And you really hear a lot of Marvin Gaye in this album in terms of the vocal layering.
But half of love is all I need. Ooh, it's too bad. It's just too sad. You don't want me now.
And I remember remember, like, when Jamiroquai came out, a lot of people compared JK's voice to Stevie Wonder. I never understood that comparison because, to me, they don't sound alike at all. I think it's really great that no one sort of criticized Lewis for sort of taking Marvin's layering and really, I don't know, giving reverence to it. I mean, he really does it, the layering, really beautifully. So I can talk a lot. Oh, another thing I want to say is what's really great about the first Lewis Taylor album, again, like Prince, he also graced us with a gazillion B-sides. Mm. I love the B-sides. My favorite B-side is Waves.
Yep.
It's so beautiful. I cry every time I listen to that song. It's one of the most beautiful songs ever recorded.
The world I live in is so lonely. I could tell you all of my trouble and strife. I just want for somebody.
And it's on the single Whoever, which is one of the songs on Lewis Taylor. So I'm going to stop talking because I could just talk on and on and on. So what about you guys? Like, what's your favorite song off of Lewis Taylor?
Well, my favorite song, I've got two. I mean, what the whole album is, you know, it's pretty exceptional. And in fact, you know, you spoke about the sequencing of the album, and to me, the best albums are like, it's going to sound really pretentious, but the best albums are auras. It's like, you know, a vibe, a tonal kind of ambient mood. And it's like, to me, it's not an album, it's an aura, because it just, it has a feeling. It's not a collection of songs. I mean, perhaps they weren't written like this, who knows, but it feels like either they were all written in the same sequence or the same sitting or the same session or the same week or whatever, or with the same emotion involved. And just like musically, tonally, they come together, you know, as one. So it's very hard to just choose one or two. But I suppose for me,
damn, I'm in love.
Song as well. And I think Damn, I just love the whole track. Song, and in fact, even in Damn, the B sections for both of those tracks are so, so powerful. Like the ending of Damn, when he's like, I'm in love with you.
Yes.
I never really wanted to. And it kind of builds and he just keeps repeating that.
Oh, I'm in love with you, baby.
And the same thing with Song, in fact, when in the B section the lyrics are finally weak, finally strong, find me strong, I get all messed up.
I get all messed up whenever you call.
Yeah, yeah.
My name. Ooh.
And he just keeps repeating that. But with the repetition, all these instruments, all these other instruments, the arrangement starts to get thicker and thicker. And the instruments get layered, and it almost gives you an orchestral vibe in the way that everything just kind of comes together. So yeah, Damn and Song are my two favorites.
Have you actually heard the cover of Song by, I'm going to bastardize his name, Jonathan Bacali? He also records as Ernesto.
I have never heard it.
Mm-mm.
Do you know Ernesto?
Don't know.
No, I tried to live your lifeless life, but I can't go back to the primal stage. Trade my love for greed and hate, and then how could I fight rage? But I know deep in my soul there's a cry for something more, and I know exactly what I need to endure.
Oh my God, his voice is amazing. He's one of those other guys too that he doesn't record as much as he should. And he used to record a lot with this guy named Andrea Sag, if I'm pronouncing his name correctly, S-A-A-G.
I'll fall into you.
A beautiful version.
He does it justice.
He really does.
Oh, I should have known there'd be trouble, baby. Ooh. When you and I have to part, but it ain't my fault that you still in my heart.
But I mean, obviously, Lewis is the best. But I actually am a huge fan of, I like calling him Ernesto only because I can say that better than Jonathan, because I don't know if I'm pronouncing his name correctly. But he started off his recording career as Ernesto, but then he switched to his real name, which is Jonathan Bacalli. Mm. And he's just a really, truly amazing vocalist. At one point, I was like, no one should cover Lewis Taylor. I'm one of those people. Certain people should not be covered. But then I was like, hey, Lewis Taylor should be covered because I want more people to sort of learn about his music and stuff. So I was actually really excited when I heard the song. And another cover I heard of another sort of unsung, unheard vocalist, well, actually singer, songwriter, guitarist, is David Ryan Harris.
She was the ocean, and I was a sailor. I'd meet her where her hands at the shore.
Ooh, I don't know, Ivan, if you ever heard of this band called Fall For Now. They were huge in the South. Mm, they're like a black rock band.
Yeah.
And so
yeah.
David Ryan Harris was, I've seen him, like, I probably saw that band the most in my youth. And he does his cover of Lucky when he was on tour with John Mayer. He became John Mayer's guitarist, which at the time I was like, John Mayer should be David Ryan Harris's guitarist, because David Ryan Harris is a pretty amazing guitarist as well as vocalist. And if you hear this live track, because David starts a show and then it transitions into John Mayer, it's just like night and day. And he does his like really, really beautiful cover of Lewis.
I get tired of this politeness. I wanna put you down. Oh, I'll just turn my back tonight. And I'll say thanks in love, but no thanks.
It kind of lets me know that some of my favorite vocalists, they know of Lewis Taylor. And so he's sort of like, I guess, the musician's musician.
Mm-hmm. Well, Beverly Knight, who's a UK soul artist, she's quite big in the UK, and she did a cover of Damn.
What's her name again?
Beverly Knight.
Oh, Beverly Knight. I didn't know she did that.
Yeah. She did it on her covers album. I think it was on a covers album. I was very, very critical of it when it dropped, and it's still not, I suppose, to my taste, but I was kind of so critical that it strikes me now, a couple of years on, that I may have been a bit unfair, because what I hear and what I like about Dan may not necessarily be what she hears and likes. And I think sometimes just with covers, we can be so sort of proprietary and possessive of the original song. And, you know, we as fans, we see it in a particular way, but we don't necessarily know what other fans would see or hear, and they may like a different aspect and want that accentuated. So while I was kind of mad when it dropped, I definitely understand that, you know, everybody's entitled to like it the way they like it. But yeah, you should look that up.
I definitely will, because I'm a completist in that regard. And I was like, there must be more that I don't know about. So I really do appreciate it.
Robbie Williams, I think, as well, who is a huge artist in the pop world. He covered Love Light.
Yes, yeah. He actually did a pretty good job of covering, only because it's pretty much verbatim. Whenever you, when you're with me, who do you think you're fooling? Making me feel so sure. And then again, you know, Lewis is better.
Oh, whenever you, baby, when you're with me, who do you think you're fooling? Making me feel so sure, turning your love light down again.
Only because with Lewis, it's the subtleties, it's the detail, it's like
of
how
course,
he holds the note, how he like modulates. It's just like his tone, like you were talking about. Nobody can do that except for maybe Marvin Gaye or somebody like that. I actually listened to it for this podcast because actually I had never listened to it before this podcast because I didn't want to listen to a pop cover of a Lewis Taylor song. But I was really surprised at it was actually pretty darn good. I mean, for what it was. So I can't hate him because I just want more awareness around Lewis Taylor's music. And hopefully that's the gateway for a lot more Lewis Taylor fans, because in my opinion, you have not lived until you've listened to Lewis Taylor, Lewis Taylor. Even though for me personally, Lewis 2 is actually my favorite Lewis Taylor album. And
what?
I know that's controversial. So we'll talk about that later.
That's funny.
I knew that was going to get something from somebody. So, Ivan, what about you? What's your favorite track?
Yeah, well, you know, I was a late bloomer, a late comer to Lewis. So my introduction was Lucky, and it still sticks with me. And Lucky was one of the first songs, and I don't know when this developed in my idiosyncratic way of dealing with music, but I think it was one of the first songs that I was aware that when I really, really like a song, there's this kind of like litmus test that I use. And basically, upon first listening, if I really like a song, I actually turn it off midway. Mm. Because I just have to process it, like, okay, what just happened there? I know it sounds weird.
You could have done small doses.
Right. Exactly. I'm like, okay, did that really just happen? And then, of course, then I go back. And then, of course, then it's just like multiple listens. But that was, yeah, Lewis was definitely one of the first artists. I mean, I've been doing that probably the last 15, 16 years. So, yeah, like I said, I was late to it because I don't know. And I don't know how I missed it in 96. But it could have been that I was still, like, you know, under the control of corporate music. I mean, knowing me, it probably was. And so this is just really great to, like, get to a point where you just see, you know, start to hear things and see things and appreciate artists that you just question, you know, the why of, okay, why wasn't this bigger at the time or whatever. So, yeah, but definitely a lucky guy here. Yeah.
So for me, I actually found out about Lewis so I was a huge acid jazz fan. And so that whole sort of movement genre. Uh-huh. And there is these series of compilations called Rebirth of Cool.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Which are really extraordinary. And they actually had Lewis Taylor's Bittersweet, which is the second song off of Lewis Taylor, on one of the compilations. There are a lot of them. And there are UK versions and US versions. And it gets confusing, so I don't remember which one is which. But yeah, I found out about him through those series of compilations. And when I heard it, I didn't shut it off.
Right.
I'm actually the opposite. I just get obsessed with the song and I play it over and over and over again, back to back to back to back. So I had, I didn't get to the rest of the album. On that particular compilation, I think it was like the second song. So I didn't even get to the rest of the compilation until like maybe a week later.
Right.
Because I just kept listening to that song over and over again.
Oh, everybody thinks I'm crazy. Stand to be so much pain. I pick up the telephone to say it's over. Soon as I hear you talk, I start it all over again. And the way that you love me, baby, bittersweet.
I think at that point, oh, I hate to say this. So for a long time, I only listened to Prince, probably like 10 years. And then, unless I was like in a car or something, I just had to listen to other music because it was sort of put upon me. But if it was up to my choosing, I just listened to Prince. But there was a certain point where it actually happened. I can tell you when it happened. So I actually got Jamiroquai's Emergency and Luke Vibert's Throbbing Pouch on the same day. Mm. Luke Vibert's Throbbing Pouch, it's just like I had never heard anything like it before. Listen to Jamiroquai because it, like I said about the song, I actually did this with the album. I just kept playing it over and over again, and it introduced me to the world of Luke Vibert, and that's like a whole nother conversation that I won't get into. And he's also from the UK, so I was really excited about that. And I eventually listened to Jamiroquai, so, and then I was really into acid jazz, so I wasn't listening to Prince a lot, but I was still kind of looking for someone who moved me the way only Prince could. And Lewis Taylor is the only person who has been able to do that. And in fact, since, you know, what happened this year, I had the same thing. I just wanted to listen to Prince. I didn't want to listen to anything else. And but to prepare for this podcast, when I started listening to Lewis, like, I just wanted to listen to Lewis. And it was so great that someone could break my Prince spell. So it's been a joy, you know, really preparing for this podcast and listening to these amazing songs. So much so that on the, I think in the 96 podcast where I talked about Stone Part 1 and Part 2 not being as good as Lewis Taylor and Lewis 2, I take that back. Stone Part 1 is actually pretty darn good. It's different. It's like lighter. Because the one thing that Jehan said, words just can't express how tonal and emotive this particular album is. Lewis Taylor is full of emotion, like the album. Like, and if you read the interview, I wish I hadn't read the interview before the podcast, because I'm so confused now about, like, what were his motives? What was he feeling when he recorded Lewis Taylor? Because before that article, if you would have asked me about this first album, whenever in the past when I talked about Lewis Taylor and I talked about Marvin Gaye, like when Marvin Gaye sung, I never trusted him. Like, I felt like he's the guy who wants to talk to you. He gives you the pretty words, but you know it won't last long. And but with Lewis, I felt like, now this is a guy who loves hard. You know, like he feels it, like, for real, for real. But after, you know, reading the interview, I was like, oh, maybe he wasn't. But I feel like he had to have been feeling some kind of emotions, because that album is one of the albums where if you don't feel something when you listen to it, then you're not human.
Well, you know what? The interview was done 20 years after the album was recorded. Mm. And, you know, by his own admission, he was going through some things when he was recording the album. And, you know, I'm not doubting him. He knows best beyond anybody else, beyond his record label, his manager, anybody else. He knows exactly what was going through his mind and what wasn't. But I don't know, speaking for myself, who among us can really speak 100% accurately on exactly how we were feeling 20 years ago when we were doing a particular thing. I think he still feels, like he mentioned in the interview, how he felt embarrassed about all but one of his records in some way. There was like some kind of embarrassment around it, whether it was the credit that he gave other people or didn't give other people, or the sound of the record or the reception it got or whatever. So I wouldn't be so disappointed, because it may not be 100% as he was describing it in the interview.
Right. No, that's a really good point. I mean, I can't even remember how I felt last week. So 20 right. years ago, I mean, you have a really awesome point. But I know that when I first heard the album, I felt something. Like, so for me, Spirit is sort of, because it's a cappella, and that to me kind of makes it different from the rest of the songs. The other song that I really, really adore is Tick. I don't know what the asterisk is for. I never understood that.
Isn't that track?
Is it track? Is that what it is? Okay, thank you. I've been wondering, like, what is this? So track, thank you, all these years. and so, like, when he sings, like, from now on, I want to be a better me if I can. Like, those words, as I say it, they sound so cliche. But when he sings it, it's like, oh, my God.
From now on.
He also sings, "And my mood is black as the darkest cloud."
And my mood is black as the darkest cloud. Shouldn't be allowed to feel this way.
Oh my God. Oh my God. So I've been listening to Prince since I was 10. And when my mom found out I was listening to Prince, like, she had a hissy fit because, you know, of all the language and the lyrics. But I never really listened to what he was singing. I was always big into how someone sings something. So someone could be singing, you know, "Mary Had a Little Lamb," and if they have the right tone and vocals, it could be amazing for me. So Lewis Taylor is one of the few artists where I actually listen to his lyrics, because he sung them so heartfelt immediately. So, like, I actually know lyrics to Lewis Taylor songs. When with certain Prince songs, if you ask me what lyrics, I still probably can tell you to this day, and I've listened to them a gazillion times. So one thing I want to stress is that not only is he this amazing musician, but he's also an amazing songwriter. I think track, thank you, Jehan. I think I wanted to make a tick for Tick, Tick, Bang.
Tick, Tick, Bang!
I do everything through Prince. It's just like... That makes sense. So a mystery solved after all these years. So yeah, so he's really, really awesome when it comes to actual songwriting.
And it's interesting, because in the interview, that was one of the things that he was saying he paid no time on, and that it was like a chore almost to write the songs. But then I think he also says elsewhere in the interview that most of the music was... most of the creation for him, even, you know, not just this album, but other albums too, was coming from his subconscious. And I think he's very keen on putting that idea across. So it may be that the lyrics, while, you know, his conscious sort of mind was just getting them out the way and just trying to go through the motions, it may be that there was a part of him that was saying, no, you need to say this stuff.
So... Lewis too. I know this is all about Lewis. And so if you poll all of Lewis Taylor's fans, I'm quite sure that Lewis Taylor is probably the favorite album, the island disc of all Lewis Taylor fans out there. But for me, Lewis too is my island disc. Whenever I want to listen to Lewis, I actually pull out Lewis too. And one of the reasons I think Lewis Taylor, I don't do it, is because, like what Jehan said, it is a certain mood. And depending, if you're super, super happy, I don't know if you can listen to Lewis Taylor, the album, because it can really sort of change your mood. And with Lewis too, even though it's not as... So Jehan talked about this earlier, and we also talked a little bit about this in regards to Parade. Lewis Taylor is definitely an album It is definitely cohesive. It definitely sounds like it was recorded at the same time. It was intentional. Those songs were intentionally for that album. Even if they weren't, they sound that way. And so I think the argument for a lot of fans about Lewis 2 is that it's not as cohesive as the first album. And I've even read some people say it's all over the place. I don't think so. I actually sort of disagree. And I actually like the Japanese version because it has like a cover of Electric Ladyland. I'm one of those people, you shouldn't cover Jimi Hendrix. Because again, I'm like, don't cover people. Like, why you want to like cover of all songs, Electric Ladyland? And but he does such a beautiful version of Electric Ladyland. So I really love that cover that he does on that.
Have you ever been to Electric Ladyland?
I like the versatility of the songs versus Lewis Taylor, which all the songs, they don't sound alike, but they definitely fit together as one. And Lewis 2 is a little... So being a Prince fan, you're sort of used to listening to all kinds of music. I think Lewis 2 sort of explores different genres, flourishes of different genres a little bit more so than the first one. My favorite Lewis Taylor lyric is in Lewis 2 when he says something like, "But so was I, we commanded attention from every single passerby." But I can't remember like the first part of that.
This is, you're talking about Never Be My Woman, right?
Yes, exactly. That's the one. That's Never Be My Woman.
Is that "You were so beautiful"?
Yes, but baby, so was I.
We commanded attention
from every single
passerby.
Yeah. Yes, I love that.
You were beautiful, baby, so was I. We commanded attention from every single passerby.
Again, such simple words, but just his delivery on that is just really, really awesome. I like all the songs on there, like "You Make Me Wanna."
I wanna. I wanna. Yeah. All the whole way down.
"Blue Eyes," it's just absolutely amazing.
"Blue Eyes."
I don't know. I just prefer it. Jehan, like you were saying before, you were like shouting out. Some people are going to be shouting out negatively. What are you talking about? But for me, it's Lewis 2. And one thing I wanted to talk about in regards to Lewis Taylor. So I love the cover for Lewis 2. I loved the original cover because there's an alternate cover where he's basically enveloped in white. And he looks really heavenly, and I like the Roman numeral 2. But the art direction for the debut album, Lewis Taylor, with the slides, I thought was really, really brilliant. And it took me a while to figure out that they were slides. Like, the cover is a slide, and then all of the singles, except for the Lucky, I have some Lucky Slim Cases. They don't use the slide metaphor, but I really liked that. Again, he had like a concept with the one word songs and with the slides. There aren't many credits, if any, in the actual booklet for Lewis Taylor, which, you know, leaves it mysterious. And I really, really liked that art direction for the first record. So if you read that interview, Lewis Taylor says that his favorite album is actually the Lost album. And the Lost album was originally supposed to be the second album instead of Lewis 2. Mm. And I got on my knees and thanked the Lord that that didn't happen because Lewis 2 is amazing. The Lost album for me, and I understand why Lewis Taylor likes the Lost album because it's more rock oriented.
Does it move in the right way when you lay it down? Does it flow like muddy water when it all comes raining down? Are you glad when it's over? Is this how it's supposed to be? Yeah, remember what we said. Yeah, try not to lose your head. Yeah.
I do think that at his heart, Lewis Taylor's actually a rocker. And then maybe he was having, I'm making this up, but the only thing I can think of is that maybe he thought he was being an imposter by, you know, sort of being the soul singer, which wouldn't make any sense to me because he truly felt it. Like, he wasn't faking it. But that's the only thing I can think of. And I had the pleasure to be at the very last Lewis Taylor concert ever.
Oh, wow.
In New York at the Bowery Ballroom on January 26th of 2006. I had never seen him live before. And in fact, I had been sort of like thinking, oh my God, I got to go over to England to see this guy. He's never going to come over here.
He doesn't perform here either. So.
I know. And so when he came over here, I was like, I am going. And in fact, like, let me give you a little context of how powerful music is. I have vowed to never get on a plane in my life ever. When Omar came to the States, he performed in New Orleans for the first time, and I got my butt on a plane to go see Omar.
Good for you.
I know. So I've been flying ever since, so thank you, Omar.
Yeah, Omar.
Yeah. But at that Bowery Ballroom gig, first of all, it was packed. I'm quite sure it was sold out. Couldn't move. And he actually did a lot of prog rock that night. And I kind of knew, and I got it. And I was like, oh, okay, we're going to go into a new direction now. Like, I was waiting for the next album. The next album was going to be a prog rock. Like, it didn't happen, but.
And the audience dug it?
Yeah.
They were up for it?
Okay. Yeah, he played a lot of prog rock. I mean, he played his own songs, of course, but he was really jamming. He looked like he was having fun, and it was a really great gig, and I'll never forget it. But then after that, like, he canceled all of his shows because, first of all, I forgot to say that Lewis Taylor was released on Island Records, which is one of my favorite record labels because of releases for Grace Jones and Bob Marley. So Island Records is a really good label. I don't know if they, it's really hard to, I guess, market Lewis Taylor to what I call the Purple Rain people, to true fans who love music and good music, it seems like it wouldn't have been a hard push. I think they could have worked it a little bit better in terms of the album promotion for Lewis Taylor. Mm-hmm. Hacktone, I think, were really working really hard to actually break Lewis Taylor, and I honestly think that that show was on the verge of really breaking Lewis Taylor as a quote-unquote star, and I think that scared the bejesus out of him. And Hacktone re-released Stoned Part 1 as Stoned, and then they released those limited editions, and then they re-released the Lost album. There's two versions of the Lost album. One version has three acoustic tracks from Lewis Taylor. The acoustic tracks are really phenomenal because, again, Lewis Taylor is a phenomenal guitarist.
I get tired of this politeness. I want what you got, or I'll just turn my back tonight, and I'll say thanks a lot for nothing if I don't get lucky, baby. You don't get lucky too.
So I wonder how Hacktone felt when Lewis Taylor was like, I'm out. But that particular show was really, truly amazing. And I knew it was something special, but I didn't realize how special it truly turned out to be since he didn't do any more shows. And it was sort of heartbreaking because I think he was planning on doing a couple of dates at the Jazz Cafe in London. And I had never been to the Jazz Cafe, and I was like, you know what? I'm going to get on a plane and go to London and see Lewis Taylor and this, because he put on such an amazing show, but it never happened. Sometimes you need to go see artists when they're performing because you never know when they might not be performing again. So I have this bucket list for artists I want to see live. I was able to see Isaac Hayes live like a month before he passed away. And it was kind of crazy, and I've missed a couple artists that I was like, what was I like smoking? I was gonna say was I smoking crack, but I know what I was doing. I was listening to Prince so hard and so long that I couldn't get anybody else a break. So I didn't have a chance to see Sarah Vaughan live, which I would have killed for that.
The sweet
sweetest sounds I'll ever hear are still inside my head.
I never got to see Etta James live. I would have killed for that.
So if it's not asking too much, please, please send me someone to love.
The night before last night, I actually got an opportunity to see Mr. Herbie Hancock. He was on my bucket list, and he was amazing. Really, truly amazing live.
He's here today.
Yeah, he's here today. So definitely.
He's doing that thing with, is it Terrace Martin?
Uh-huh. Yep.
Yes, and Terrace was there. So,
oh, cool.
Yeah, he was there playing keys and horns and stuff like that. And actually, Robert Glasper opened up for him. And Jamie Lydell, who's another guy I absolutely love. Jamie Lydell was the opener. Jamie Lydell is going to come out with a new album very soon, in a couple months. Robert Glasper just released a new, well, it's going to be dropping very, very soon. And then Herbie Hancock announced that Terrace Martin is going to be producing his next record. So a lot more new music to look forward to from all three of them. But what was really cool about the Robert Glasper set, even though it was super, super short, was that he brought out Bilal. And Bilal is my other soul singer, the guy I can feel when he wants to sing. So Bilal is very fickle. Sometimes he croons, sometimes he doesn't want to croon. Like you never know what kind of Bilal you're gonna get when you see him. And he wasn't very much for crooning that night. But this song, which is a song off of Bilal's debut album that was produced by JD, because Robert Glasper always pays tribute to JD. And then Robert Glasper was like, I met this rapper backstage. He said that he think he can rap, and he brings him out as Common. And so Bilal used to be Common's backup singer. Bilal sung a lot on Common's album, the green cover one.
Like Water for Chocolate.
Yes, Like Water for Chocolate. So Bilal was all over that record.
Yeah. You know, you don't have to worry no more. Cause you got my shoulder to cry on, and baby, it's gonna be alright. Okay, it's gonna be alright. Okay.
I hadn't seen them together in a very, very long time, so it was a really awesome to see them together again.
Oh, that's cool.
As one, and so.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Herbie Hancock was really, really great. We started this like rant because it's really important to go see people, performers live when they're performing, and don't say I'll see them next time.
Yeah.
Yeah, because sometimes next time doesn't happen. Hmm. And that's definitely the case with Lewis Taylor, which is really a shame. But if you know anything about Lewis Taylor, it's not surprising, because what I found very strange about when Lewis Taylor was released, he didn't tour for Lewis Taylor. And in fact, when it dropped, he actually went on tour with Finley Quay.
To the rescue, here I am. I want you to know, y'all, here I stand. As the morning gathers a rainbow, I want you to know now that I'm a rainbow.
Finley Quay's guitarist and musical director when he had just released his own debut album, and it seems like he would have been promoting his own album, but obviously that's not Lewis Taylor. So that kind of gave me an inkling that this is not your average guy. Like, who releases an album and then chooses to go tour with somebody else as their guitarist? I think that's kind of weird. I've been talking a lot. Is there anything else
it's passion.
I know. I love Lewis Taylor. Oh, my God.
I'm just interested in you all's thoughts. I mean, you know, we've done a couple of podcasts, and obviously we're 20 years out from 96. But I guess, you know, you all's thoughts as to why. I mean, one, we did discuss, you know, the fact that he didn't tour behind, that Lewis didn't tour behind this record. But are there any other things that you think, just the nature of the environment musically in 96, or just the way the business was working, that contributed to why this record may not have broken through more than it did? You know, any thoughts that y'all, yeah.
It's funny because I was thinking exactly that a few minutes ago.
Yeah.
And it's interesting. And, you know, it's purely, you know, armchair speculation because none of us were working for the label or what have you. But you're absolutely right. In terms of what was big then, it's like hip hop was having its first kind of global acceptance and golden age, if you like. And I wonder if labels were very much focused on that sound such that more traditional kind of singer-songwriters were not seen necessarily as something that the public wanted as much of. You know, if Island had a Nas or a Biggie or whatever, it might have been, maybe artists like that took their attention. The other thing I was going to say, but I'm going to contradict myself in a second again. One thing that he said in the interview was that the marketing department, the A&R department, Island Records, had no problem with it. They loved him from, I think it was from Lucky and Bittersweet. Those are the two tunes that they had. And they dug him and they said, right, we're right behind you. But he said that the marketing department, quote unquote, didn't know what to do with the album, didn't know which genre it fell into. Now, you know, that's fair enough. But I think as D'Angelo mentioned towards the start of the show, Brown Sugar had dropped very, very recently as well.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that had a huge amount of success, surprising success at that time. And clearly the sort of audience was there for someone who, for a singer-songwriter, wanted to do non-traditional R&B at that time, traditional mm-hmm. R&B, or, you know, mm-hmm. popular R&B at that time, let's say,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
or hip-hop. The only differences I can think of between the albums, apart from, you know, being different music, is, broadly speaking, perhaps Brown Sugar has more of a hip-hop reference than Lewis Taylor does.
Yeah.
And like the people who like Tribe Called Quest can very easily translate to Brown Sugar beat-wise, whereas perhaps less easily. But I mean, I don't think it's a huge stretch, but perhaps it's less of an immediate jump. And the other thing is, and this will probably ensure I'll never be able to get a record deal in the UK, but I wonder if Lewis Taylor was signed to an American label, not licensed by Hacktone he'd already had a couple of albums out, but if he was signed and nurtured and promoted by an American label to an American audience, I wonder if that would have had a different result.
Mm.
I actually don't think it would have, because you actually bring up a really interesting point about the D'Angelo record, Brown Sugar, is that hip hop was really huge, right? Because you had like Tupac's
All Eyes On Me
came out in 96, the Fugees, The Score,
Ready or Not,
Outkast, AT Aliens,
Me and You,
Tribe's Beats, Rhythm and Life,
Fight Dog, swing it back and forth just like Aaliyah.
Yeah.
And Lewis Taylor, like the album, is so darn musical. And as, how old is, I'm 45, 46, I'm like that now. And I feel like music is getting more and more away from musicality and like the denseness that is on that Lewis Taylor. Only like true music heads can really get that. I feel like he was behind, meaning like he would have been better if he would have came out like the 60s, 70s.
Mm.
Absolutely. I mean, they're definitely every year. 2015 was a good year with a lot of good music, and 2016 is a good year. They're all, if you're really into it, you can find great stuff all over the place. But I think undeniably, certainly in the mainstream public eye, there's been a huge descent in quality. If you look at the top 40 in the 80s, there's a lot of good songs in there, as in their songs. You take all the instruments away, take the singer out of it, take, you know, no video, and just play it on the guitar or on the piano, mm-hmm. it's a nice song.
Yep.
Right.
But that's a bit harder to do in 2016. You know?
That's true, right.
So I definitely agree with you there. But something that you might find interesting is the first Lewis Taylor song that I heard was Whoever. And it was because there was a video for it. So I was watching MTV or whatever, and they played it. Wow. Now, Whoever might be maybe the happiest song on Lewis Taylor. And, you know, it has that sort of Take Six kind of vocal ensemble vibe right in the beginning. And then you have the guitar and everything, and you know, the chorus is upbeat and uplifting, and
whoever is the love in your life, hey yeah, ooh, yeah. Whoever is the love,
just musically it's a bright kind of happy song
from experience,
just kind of not what the album's about.
No.
So I heard the track, I loved it, I was hugely into Take Six at that time. I thought, I gotta check this guy out. So I went to my local Tower Records, and they had listening posts. You know, you remember we used to have that. You used to have CD and the headphones, and you could.
Yeah.
So they, you know, they had the Lewis Taylor album there. So I thought, let me check it out. I was much younger back then. I listened to the opening, and I thought, hang on, this isn't what I was expecting. So I didn't listen to the full track. I just listened to the opening, and then I played the second track again. It was different, and then Whoever's the third track. So I will skip to the fourth track, and again, it was different. Whoever kind of starts straight away, right? You've got the claps in the beginning and the vocals, and then bam, the track starts. Whereas the others, they have a bit more of a build.
Yeah.
Or most of the others have a bit more of a build. So I wonder if maybe they promoted it to the wrong demographic. Mm. Maybe Whoever shouldn't have been the first single, and maybe they should have released an edited version of one of the other songs as the first single. You know, I mean, I hate edits. God forbid anything ever sort of changes the artist's vision. But just in terms of catching the demographic.
I'm really going through my mental
Rolodex
here because, at that time in 96, well, I was starting to wane a little bit. But I was going to say, like, from, say, I don't know, 85 or 84, whenever we got BET, until probably 95, 96, I mean, I was like a video junkie, and I'm trying to remember if I ever saw Whoever. Because I know that there are many, many artists that broke, you know, first on BET. Like, I mean, I could name a gazillion of them. Paula Abdul, notwithstanding. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you'd see that, you know, for a couple of months, then the next thing, you know, it hits MTV. But I can't remember if I ever, because I think that would have stuck with me, but I'm not sure.
So that's an interesting point. So you're saying that basically, even though that was the first single, it may not have garnered a huge amount of, or it may not have broken through. So people may not have had the quote-unquote wrong impression of the album. Yeah, no, I feel you. Yeah. I think maybe part of this is something else that I often think about, that it really helps to have a sponsor, to have co-signs and support from other artists, public support from other artists. Mm-hmm. So if you take D'Angelo, for example, is undeniable talent. You know, he's a bad cat. There's no two ways about it. But were it not for Questlove kind of doubling in this co-producer stroke publicist, you know, were it not for Questlove constantly on OK Player or Twitter saying, oh my God, I've just heard this D'Angelo track, and you're not ready, blah, 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 the stuff that he likes to do. Were it not for that constantly, were it not for this kind of elite New York City brain trust of journalism, so the Nelson Georges of the world, those cats kind of constantly, you know, the Dream Hamptons constantly saying, this is the guy, telling us that this is the guy. We would listen to the album, whatever, but we're not the people who make artists money.
Right.
We're such a small portion. So I wonder if Lewis had a Questlove at that time, constantly in his corner, if he had a Dream Hampton or Miles Marshall Lewis in his corner at that time, writing about him, and then, you know, when he's about to drop hitting whatever the promotion avenue was back then. I wonder if that would have been different.
I think that's an amazing point. I think you're definitely on to something. I want to say at the time, correct me if I'm wrong, I heard that D'Angelo and Lewis Taylor met or were going to meet and were thinking about recording something. I remember reading that somewhere. And I think that would have been really amazing for, well, first of all, for all music lovers, but also for Lewis Taylor in terms of his exposure in the U.S., So I was a little disappointed when that didn't transpire.
Well, I heard that too. So I've often said Lewis Taylor's debut is very, very much informative for Voodoo. I cannot believe that it wasn't a huge influence on Voodoo, like tonally, vibe, ambient, mood. Right. Whole vibe is very, very much what kind of Voodoo is going for as well. They're very kindred spirits as albums in that way. And I could be completely misremembering this, so please, someone feel free to correct me, either right now or on social media. But Questlove, I believe, I remember, wrote a post on OK Player about Quest and D'Angelo inviting Lewis Taylor out to the States. I think it was Virginia for part of the sessions for Voodoo. I think Questlove said there was something along the lines of a misunderstanding or a mistake, whereby they said, yeah, get to the hotel and we'll come and pick you up. And it didn't happen. They sort of sent a message again saying, sorry, we'll do it tomorrow, but just, you know, just hang and, you know, we'll be there. And I don't know if that went on just for 1 or 2 days or a number of days, but at some point, Lewis Taylor apparently said, no, I'm going home. This is not right. So that's apparently why it didn't happen.
Oh, well, yeah, that's really sad. I think it would have been really interesting. But at the same time, maybe it wouldn't have, because there's a couple of instances where I was super disappointed after hearing a collaboration of two people I truly admired. So I heard this collaboration with, who was it? Stuart Zender, who was the bassist for Jamiroquai, who I just adored. He's one of the best bass players ever. And I want to say the collaboration was with D'Angelo. Yeah, and it just wasn't as magical as I thought it was going to be. There was another collaboration. Oh, so I'm a huge Doyle Bramhall II fan.
Oh, okay.
Massive. Massive, even though I hate him as a man, what he did to Susanna. Yeah, so I'm sorry, Susanna, but I separate the man from his music, and I just love Doyle Bramhall II's music.
Over now, mercy, mercy to the broken ones. Good to know I'm right in time to watch the day come down.
So Doyle Bramhall II actually collaborated with Erykah Badu, and I thought it was going to be amazing. And if you listen to it, it's like, it's just standard fare. It's
all around the world, been round and
not sparks flying. And
what track was this?
It was, I wish I could remember the name, but it's actually on this, there's this amazing DVD called
When the Music
When the Music Died.
Dies,
When the Music Died. Yeah. And they actually show them in the studio, and I actually have the song, but that just kind of show you that I literally took it out of my mental Rolodex because I was so darn disappointed. So I have to tell you what the song is later. And it's a really good documentary. And Erykah Badu was in it. Doyle Bramhall, Susanna was in it.
And sure was.
Yeah, they were still together at that time.
I think that was my folks in Charlottesville who had something to do with the ATO, Dave.
Oh yeah,
Matthews,
I think it was.
Label and folks and Korn and all those guys. Yeah. But a great documentary though.
Yeah, it was a really great documentary. So like, I just think that because Lewis Taylor and D'Angelo, I feel like they're such great musicians. I gotta think that that would have been magical. But again, I don't know. Like, so one thing that I hate is that I was a huge Raphael Sadiq fan in terms
Hold up. What do you mean was?
Nah, yeah, I was gonna ask too.
Right.
Let me tell you. So I loved Raphael Sadiq's voice. I thought it was like so great. It's so amazing. But then he did that song with D'Angelo.
Be here.
And I was like, why?
Hey,
I was like,
hey, why you wanna go and do that? Do that. Hey, why you wanna go and do that?
Because like D'Angelo just wiped the floor, and I never, you know, look at Raphael the same.
Right,
and I go like, oh, he can't sing. Okay, I'm being really mean. But it was just like D'Angelo sung that song. I was like, don't ever do a duet with D'Angelo. Like, don't go back and forth with D'Angelo.
Okay, but to be fair, if Rafael Sadiq and D'Angelo never collaborated, you wouldn't have Untitled.
Yeah.
That
is true.
Okay, point taken, Jehan. We want that to exist for sure. So that's a very, very good point.
Oh, man.
Yeah. Actually, I'm talking about Stuart Zender. One thing I didn't talk about Lewis Taylor, the album, is that it's one of the albums, I think it's one of the only albums, like at least in the 2000s, that the bass was a main focal point throughout the entire album. Like the bass is up in the mix. It's some amazing bass playing. And that's actually one of the things I wish that Prince would have done, like in terms of an entire album. Like, I wanted, like, a bass album from Prince. I wanted, like, a piano album from Prince. It's, like, all these albums I kind of wanted. And I think that the Lewis Taylor album is just really extraordinary for all of the musicality and the musicianship on that album. But the bass is really outstanding. One thing also is I didn't realize, I was under the assumption until I read that interview, Soul Jones. Like, I love and hate that interview. Thank you. But not at the same time. I was always under the impression that Lewis Taylor did both, meaning like both Lewis Taylor and Lewis 2 were just Lewis Taylor, just him by himself. Until I read this interview where he said that Sabine Smith, his collaborator, actually had a huge part in Lewis Taylor. And I think that's also another reason why, even though I didn't know it at the time, that I actually prefer Lewis 2.
Mm-hmm.
It's because Lewis 2 is actually just all Lewis, according to, you know, the interview, the Soul Jones interview. And so before I read the interview and back when this was transpiring in real time, another reason why my memory of Stone Part 1 wasn't so keen was because I hate it when the same thing happened with Prince, like when he's Prison of the Revolution, like when he started doing Prison of the Revolution, I was like, I was not happy. Even though I love the Revolution now, so don't hate me. I'm going to see them in Minneapolis in a couple of weeks. So I love you, Wendy and Lisa and everybody else. But at the time, I was like, Prince doesn't need anybody. He's fine by himself. Why is he collaborating? And the same thing happened with Lewis Taylor. I was like, he was just fine on Lewis Taylor and Lewis 2. He doesn't need a producer. And then I felt like that's when there was less emotion with Stone Part 1 and Stone Part 2 at the time. But going back the past couple, well, actually more like a month, I've been listening to Lewis Taylor kind of nonstop. I realized that Stone Part 1 is actually a pretty brilliant album.
So you've wasted all your tears, but that's the way it goes.
Stone Part 2, I still feel, is too pop, too dance. It's very disco. It's like he was trying to do a disco record. I don't understand it.
Didn't I do you right? Did you have to leave me tonight? Girl, I'm begging you, please, won't you reconsider? Didn't I do you right? Did you have to leave me tonight? Girl, I'm begging you, please, won't you reconsider?
But one thing I do like about Lewis Taylor, if you do sort of start collecting his music. It's all the different versions of certain songs. And so, you know, like you could be like a musicologist, you like truly study how a song could change depending on how you change different things about that song. And Lewis does that really great. Because like on Stone Part 1, Shame is amazing.
Now it's over and done. Do you hear what I say? Didn't I always tell you we'd end up this way?
Stone Part 2, Shame, is not so amazing.
Now it's over and done. Do you hear what I say? Didn't I always tell you we'd end up this way?
And it's the same song, but it's just like the different backing track and everything really can change the song. So being like, I was really shocked and surprised to hear that she wasn't credited like she was supposed to on the first album. So that was news to me that she had so much influence on the Lewis Taylor album.
Because he was saying that she wrote, she produced, she arranged. Which, you know, so it's hard to know what was him and
what was that. Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, I guess I have the same view, but on the opposite side, which is, I perhaps wish there were more collaborations between them, because a debut is far and away my favorite. Although I will admit to saying that I heard two once and I didn't hear it again.
What?
Because, well, simply because it wasn't the same vibe as the original. It was actually more in keeping with whoever. It was brighter. It didn't have that kind of murkiness.
Yeah.
But I heard it on a long drive recently. I was just kind of going through his albums. Once I just let it play, there's a lot of decent songs on there, and
they're
definitely
more than
resonated.
They're more than decent, John.
And it resonated with me much more than it did the first time. Again, I don't know if I'm remembering this right. I still haven't heard it a huge amount. I think maybe the programming on the album dates it a little bit more than perhaps the programming on the debut. And the debut, because of that, it perhaps more of a timeless quality. I feel, generally speaking.
No, I understand what you're saying.
This isn't like particular to Lewis Taylor as an artist, but I feel generally when music has a heavy reliance on technology as opposed to real instruments and real musicianship, that you find that it just dates quite easily.
Yeah, I would actually say that about Stone Part 1 and 2 more so than Lewis 2, but I'm not dismissing what you're saying because I totally understand what you're saying and can hear it. But for me, the album actually still holds up. It doesn't sound dated because of all the stuff on top of it. His vocals, the guitar and bass playing, like some of the drum programming, yes.
No, I hear you.
And let me tell you something. I have two copies of Lewis 2. I only have one copy of Lewis Taylor. Sometimes I buy multiple copies and I give them to my mom and other people just in case my house burns down or something like that. And I can always like have another copy. I'm really surprised. You can actually find a lot of Lewis Taylor on iTunes. You can find his album. It's not like gone. Speaking of dated, one thing I wanted to do before we did this podcast that I didn't have an opportunity to do was actually listen to the Lucky remixes. Because they were remixed by Kruder and Dorfmeister. I don't know, I'm really bad with pronunciation. And they were hot at that time, they were huge. And they did like a drum and bass remix of Lucky. Mix, and I thought it was interesting at the time that they actually got KND to remix Lewis Taylor. They, you know, were very much into the electronica DMB scene, and I don't know. I think some people shouldn't be remixed, and I think Lewis is one of those people. But
I kind of agree with what you're saying. It's more than it being sort of some people. Mm-hmm. Whatever you're doing has to fit, and it has to be
right.
Done for the right reasons. And I didn't like the remixes on day one when they were released, and whether it is or isn't who he is as an artist, because in the interview he was very, very keen on saying he can do anything.
Right.
That wasn't what that album was. And there were taking a square peg and trying to shove it into a round hole just to sell. It just seems so inauthentic to me.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly. So there's the CD floating around, which I've never been able to get a copy of, that was supposedly given away at some gig where he does all these covers of like of rock tunes and stuff like Led Zeppelin and all that. Have you ever had the opportunity to listen?
No, I haven't. I don't have that. And I've never heard of that actually. What I do have is I've got a kind of, I don't even want to call it prog rock. There's a kind of psychedelic kind of rock CD called, is it Cap? Hang on, let me get the name.
Is it Captain Beefheart or something like that?
Yeah, that's right. I can get the exact name. Give me one sec. Yeah, Beefheart's Trout Mask Replica Reborn.
Yeah.
So you have to forgive me for that not rolling immediately off the tongue.
Just fine.
Yeah, I mean, so Lewis Taylor has recorded under other aliases before Lewis Taylor, because he also recorded as Sheriff Jack well. And to be honest, I thought that maybe he would take on another alias and record as somebody else, you know, if he was done with like his quote unquote Lewis Taylor phase, but that actually never happened.
Well, I don't know, because he was so kind of cagey in that interview about what he's doing. So he said he wasn't recording, but then he also said that when he was dismayed about the record label not getting in touch with him for the re-release of the record, he said, it's not as if they couldn't contact me via the business circles that we move in.
Right.
So that seemed to me to be an indication that he's still involved in music to some degree, somehow. But he was so cagey about what he's doing, it's hard to know.
That interview is so elliptical. I don't know what to think. I've read it twice. I probably need to read it three or four more times. And I still won't learn anything new because it is just so elliptical. But it just seems like he doesn't care about music. Because if I read the interview correctly, like he was performing with that prog rock group, which I can't remember the name of, a little bit after he stopped touring. And I just assumed, you know, I was really excited about this 2016 interview because I thought he was going to sort of reveal to us all of his hidden side projects and things of that nature that he had been working on. And it turned out not to be the case. So my feeling is that he isn't recording music, and it doesn't even sound like he's not even playing music. And then like him going back and forth about whether or not the label can contact him, I think on the one hand, I don't think he cares, but then it seems like he does care at the same time. Mm. And so it's really weird because like what was really great was when they were talking about that re-release of the 20th anniversary of Lewis Taylor and what the label could have done. And like all the stuff that he suggested would have been brilliant. Like, you know, putting all the B-sides and like the acoustic versions and things of that nature on it would have been really, really brilliant. So I looked up while you were looking up stuff. There was this limited edition 2002 CD. There were only 100 copies made and they were given away at this gig in the UK. And it basically had a Bee Gees cover on it, a Night Fever, a Deep Purple cover of Highway Star, a Yes cover of Heart of the Sunrise, and a Led Zeppelin cover of Black Dog, as well as the three acoustic versions of Track, Song, and Lucky. But as I mentioned before, you can actually find those on one of the versions of the Lost album, the one that Hacktone released. And then there's also an acoustic version of If I Lay Down With You. And then there was a Brian Wilson cover of Melt Away and a Stylistics cover of Stop, Look, and Listen. But Stop, Look, and Listen actually got released on one of the subsequent CDs. I don't know if it was the limited edition 2004 release. I can't remember off the top of my head.
It's never too late to stop, look, listen to your heart, hear what it's saying. Stop, look, listen to your heart, hear what
I said, you know, at the beginning of this, Lewis Taylor, as Lewis Taylor, has put out a lot of music, and we really can't hate on him if he chooses not to continue to record for us. But I just think that especially in light of Prince's death, like somebody needs to do something. And it's just, I feel like he has, that Lewis Taylor has a lot more music inside of him. And I'll take it any way he wants to put it out. If he wants to go all prog rock, if he wants to go straight rock, I'll take it. I just think that, I don't know. I'm going to stop wishing. After that interview, like, it's useless to wish because I just don't think he's going to do it. Another one of my favorite artists actually retired at the same time. So that year was sort of devastating. It was this UK artist named Domu. Amazing albums. Then he released another album as U-Mod, which is Don't Move Backwards. I was just really, really looking forward to like his career. I thought he was gonna be like vibrant, like very prolific, always releasing stuff. Or Mark Pritchard, another guy who like changes aliases, like, you know, you change your shirts. And I just thought I was gonna be like down that rabbit hole trying to figure out what was his next alias. But in Domu's case, he was like, he didn't like the person he was becoming as an artist, because he was doing like a lot of gigs and he was like the owners and stuff weren't paying him, and he was just getting irate and very, very negative, and he just stopped. And I was like, crazy town. And then Lewis Taylor was like, nothing, peep. And so it's just so weird. But one thing that Lewis Taylor does bring out in the article that he made very, very clear is that, unlike me, when I was talking about Doyle Bramhall II, where you can separate the man from the music, Lewis Taylor's clear that you can't separate them in that article, like, because he's more concerned about being a human being than being a musician. For me, that was very clear. Jehan, didn't you get that from the article?
Yeah, I think it's different for the audience to hear music and decide whether or not they can separate just the sound that's coming through their speakers from the person, you know, their personality and their actions, who's creating it. I think that's different to what he felt happening with his success or his attention or his development. I think he was saying that, so I don't necessarily think it was like the music necessarily that was, so I'm probably not making much sense. I don't think it was necessarily the music that was making him be a certain way, or I don't think that's, I didn't get that he was saying that. I think he was just saying he wasn't spending enough time developing himself as a person. I think he made reference to the fact that he'd never really developed the way he thought he would, because from a very young age, he was studying music full time and putting everything into the music. So he seems to say in the interview that he woke up one day and felt, hang on, you know, I'm not who I should be. I'm not who I want to be, because I've put all this time and all this energy into music, but I haven't developed into the kind of person I want to be. And he mentioned some sort of negative qualities that he felt he had, personality-based, and how he treated people. But yeah, you're absolutely right, though. The net result is the same, that he felt he couldn't carry on doing, or he says he felt that he couldn't carry on doing what he was doing and be the kind of person he wanted to be at the same time.
And that really takes a lot of integrity.
Huge amount, huge amount.
Yeah, huge, 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 huge amount. Yeah. And a lot of artists, or so-called artists, should really take heed to that.
And it can be hard for us to understand because, you know, I could say we all have jobs. We all have ways that we make money, or we all have things that we spend our time on. And it would be very rare for most people to change as a person because of what they're doing to that degree where they have to sort of stop everything. One would think most people would be able to say, okay, hang on, I'm not treating this person the way I want to treat them. Let me just be nicer to that person.
But right.
doesn't mean they've got to unplug everything and throw the baby out with the bathwater. But he, of course, more than anybody else, knows himself. And I respect the fact that he knew that perhaps that was a limitation of his, that he couldn't do both at the same time and had the course correct, as it were.
Right. So to sort of wrap up, I just really want to stress to all of the GFM listeners out there that Lewis Taylor's debut album should be listened to, and it should be listened to with reverence. Like, I don't think you should be skipping tracks. I think you need to set aside time to, you know, an hour to listen to this thing from beginning and the end in a sacred space.
I like that.
Yeah. So you can really hear, so you can really listen to it, because it's truly, truly a masterpiece. It really is. And people use that word all of the time, but in this case, it's truly true. So I want to make sure that Jehan can tell us all about the Music Snobs.
Absolutely.
And anything else he's up to?
Well, the Music Snobs is a podcast that is similar to this. We discuss music. I'm really selling it, aren't I? It's a bit more combative than this, for better or for worse. So this has been a welcome break. We talk about music. We're passionate about music. And you can find us at musicsnobs.com or SoundCloud/TheMusicSnobs.
So I am waiting for that Prince podcast, you know.
It's coming, man. It's coming. It's almost done. It's almost ready.
The plug is just a couple of things. So I've been debating whether or not I'm going to do a Lewis Taylor mix. I don't think Lewis Taylor can really be mixed, so I probably won't end up doing it, but I'm thinking about it. But I'm definitely going to do a mix for Lisa Coleman. There's only one Lisa in my world, because her birthday is next week. So that's the next thing that I'm going to do. And we're going to be doing a lot more GFM podcasts. I'm so excited about the Jesse Johnson Shakadelica. I can't wait until we do that one.
Are you doing that? Fantastic.
Yeah, we're going to do that because it's going to be the 30-year anniversary in October.
Wow.
Yeah, and then we're going to do Emancipation. That's probably going to be combative.
right.
Yeah, at least on my side, because I'm not a huge Emancipation fan. And I know, Ivan, I think you're going to be talking a lot on that one, because I know that you like Emancipation a lot.
I do.
let me do one thing for you, because I'm going to send you, D'Angela, my streamlined Emancipation like my personal sequencing, what I would have done had I been in charge.
Yeah.
And it's like, if you reduce it to one disc, could have been a classic.
Okay. I actually look forward to that.
Yeah, that's cool.
So I'll send it to you guys.
Yeah. And then I also want to do one for Jamiroquai's Traveling Without Moving, even though technically the US release wasn't until 1997. Okay. But the UK version was released in 1996. So, all right, definitely want to do that. So, it's been a pleasure, Jehan.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
It really means a lot.
It really
my
pleasure.
Does.